Bowman Institute and Sarah Lawrence College to this, which is an annual endowed lecture which honors Thomas Wright, who was a member of the Sarah Lawrence Board of Trustees and a great supporter of the college and of the Child Development Institute. And in his honor, the Leon Lowenstein Foundation established an endowed fund for CDI, and we chose to use it for this lecture open to the public and for some aspects of our Empowering Teachers program, which is something that is an ongoing activity, and we like the idea of combining something that's a special event and open to a lot of people with something that's a sort of ongoing working project for some. If you guys want to come downstairs, there are seats down here. Go back out there, back out the door, down the steps, and through the door here. Okay. It's a little better if it, not to have people up there if we can help it, so Mary can see who she's talking to. As I look out at this group, I realize that almost everybody in this room already knows Mary Hebron. So it makes me feel a little foolish to try to introduce her. But I think that I'll just say a couple of things that will not hopefully be redundant. All of you who know Mary know that she is a teacher and a teacher of teachers, and that she helped found and has been teaching in for its entirety the Art of Teaching program at Sarah Lawrence, which is a unique graduate program, many of whom of you have been through that program. Right, go. She has lots of teaching experience in various schools across the grades, and is currently a consultant to the Ella Baker School in New York, which some of you probably teach at. And any cheers for Ella Baker? Okay. But I thought I would just tell you that when we plan each year's Empowering Teachers program, and by the way, you're all invited to read about that and think about coming to it at some future summer, we think about a theme, and then we try to think about a speaker for the right to invite to give the right lecture that would whose work resonates with that theme and who would set what we used to call the keynote address for that for the week. And so this summer, as we were talking about bringing a theme that's always part of our work into the foreground, that is the challenge of keeping teaching about individual children, and I would say individual teachers, in this era of incredible standardization, maybe now more than ever, of both curriculum and assessment, we realized that the very best person to be our Wright lecturer was right here with us, and that was Mary Hebron. And that's because this, the idea of thinking with teachers about children and keeping children at the center of the educational process, which seems like a no-brainer, but in fact is an idea that seems to escape large numbers of professionals in the field of education, also those in government, also parents sometimes. And Mary's work in relation with Pat Carini and in relation to the Prospect Center, but also all of her teaching here and her outreach professional development work for teachers, both our own graduates and out in the field, always is about looking at children, thinking about them, and teaching based on what you see and hear from them and learn from them, as well as reflecting on your own experience. And those things can't be separated out, really, conceptually. So it was a no-brainer for us to ask Mary to be the Wright lecturer this year. And fortunately, she agreed. And she's also agreed that after she speaks, she will answer questions or have some conversation with you guys. Following all of that, there'll be some refreshments outside, and we invite you to join us for that. So I'm not going to take up any more time. I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you. It's really strange to have so many people who know me here because you've heard it all before. But I'm so glad to be here. I'm really honored to have the right to be offered the Wright Lecture as this year's Empowering Teachers, part of this year's Empowering Teachers Summer Institute. I want to thank Jan and the CDI Advisory Board for extending the invitation to me. I'm excited to get to know those of you who are participating this week for a little bit today and then again tomorrow. Seated in this auditorium are so many teachers, educators who have inspired me with their tireless effort on behalf of children. I want to acknowledge Dr. Calvert Schlick, whose work in the Mamaroneck schools was always about bringing the voices of children and the voices of teachers to the forefront. And I want to acknowledge Sarah Wilford, who couldn't be here today. She's in Italy. Director of our Art of Teaching program at Sarah Lawrence, for her belief in a different vision for teacher education. In preparing this talk, I had to ask myself, why am I the one standing here talking to you when so many in this audience hold the current stories of children, schools, teaching that I only know peripherally, have been privileged to know by being alongside? What can I say that will be at all interesting or useful? Perhaps my purpose today can be to share what I've learned by being in so many classrooms and hearing teacher stories over the years, share a bit of what I've learned from the many teachers, educators I've known who have been and are trying to maintain a space for the voices of children. I'm going to begin my talk in the year 1973, my first year teaching in a public school, in the hope that I can draw forward implications for today, for what looking back may have to tell us about making space for each child in today's schools and classrooms, what looking back can say to us about reclaiming the voices of teachers in finding multiple pathways, part of the focus this year, so that each child can reclaim her own meaning making. I hope you will soon see why I started in this way. I entered my first public school teaching position in Greenberg, not far from here, and I began my teaching life with the generous support of Rena Hirsch, my first principal, who spoke with me every morning, often for more than an hour before my kindergartners arrived, about the particular children in my class and about how to engage them as thinkers and learners. I remember vividly the first staff meeting I attended in Greenberg, where to my amazement, teachers entered the room and greeted one another with a smile and an embrace. I came to know that this show of affection was backed by caring attention, as when each day my more experienced colleagues came to my classroom to ask how things were going, to talk about a child, to borrow an idea or offer one. I was invited to the weekly potluck in the homes of Greenberg teachers to share teaching stories, raise questions, and gain important insights from others engaged in daily work with children. What that first experience taught me is the importance of teachers being there for one another. It taught me what it means to be valued and nurtured. What Rena Hirsch and the teachers in Greenberg provided me with is the best of professional development, appreciation for me as a person, for what I brought to teaching, and the space in which to make that visible. It was my Greenberg colleagues who in 1974 first brought me to the place that was to have the biggest influence on my teaching life, the Prospect School and Center in North Bennington, Vermont. There I met Patricia Carini and a circle of educators who were looking at children and teaching in a way that was at the time new to me, though I understood immediately that the focus was on getting to know the capacities of each and every child. The focus on getting to know the capacities of each and every child was a perfect fit for what I valued, for what I was striving for in my own work with children. The philosophy, ideas, and descriptive processes developed at the Prospect School and Center were to become the foundation on which I would build my teaching of children and later the teaching of teachers here at Sarah Lawrence. I learned a way of looking, a way of making teacher knowledge through ongoing observation and documentation of children and children's work. And I'll get back to that in a little bit. Also in those early years of my teaching, I was so fortunate to find my way to the workshop center at City College created by Lillian Weber. Well equipped with arts, science, math, literacy materials, and books, the workshop center made a space for teachers who attended from across the New York metro area to discover together what it means to provision the classroom with resources rich with opportunity, to provide multiple entry points that include the range of children and approaches to learning the children bring, opportunities for children to be makers of their own meaning and knowledge. To appreciate the possibilities of each medium and activity, we engaged with them ourselves, applying our own questions and thoughts, making and doing to get inside the big ideas, learning through a hands-on process what it means to make knowledge for yourself, and to consider what it means for the children we teach. I'll never forget constructing a geodesic dome with a group of teachers under the guidance of Eleanor Duckworth, the renowned science educator. I came to see firsthand, and for the first time in my education, the geometry of the triangle and its value in building the strongest of structures. I bring up these early professional experiences, which I and many other teachers of my generation were fortunate to have, because I believe that this is what is sorely missing in much of teacher development today, though of course present in particular schools and professional settings we know. In these thoughtful circles in which I was privileged to participate as a beginning teacher and over time, teaching was understood to be intellectual work. The professional offerings from which I could choose were not scripted, nor preformed or predigested. New and experienced teachers could work alongside one another, raise questions to one another, collaborate in thinking about the children and their care, and what made sense in teaching each one. Teachers' voices, veteran and novice, were honored in the quest to imagine what is possible in educating when children's voices are listened to and heard. Times have changed. I know many in this audience can attest the approach to professional development is now rarely in the hands of teachers, even in early childhood. Nor does it tend to be in the hands of principals richly endowed, as Rena Hirsch was, or as Ella Baker's Laura Garcia is, with knowledge of children and teaching. Most professional development is outsourced to so-called expert consultants at considerable cost to school districts. They bring canned programs into schools already overwhelmed by the imposition of mandated curriculum. It is less and less about teachers as intellectuals, making knowledge about teaching and learning from firsthand experience with children and with subject matter. Too often today, the child, each one unique and capable, is not the center of attention, though the claim is otherwise. The focus is on scripted programs and on amassing minute bits of meaningless data, so meaningless and burdensome that a teacher at the end of her career said to me recently that she was leaving teaching frustrated that the more data she was required to collect, the less time she had to get to know the children. I return now to what I came to understand at the Prospect School and the Workshop Center, which has influenced everything I've done in teaching since and enabled my desire to become a different kind of teacher than many I had in my own schooling. I realized that what is required is a shift in thinking, from focusing first on what the teacher does to noticing first what the children are doing, to hear what they are saying. I began to recognize the essential role in teaching of observing what the children can do, what they do within settings that enable each one to be visible through interest and strength, words I'll repeat many times in this talk. I came to know that it is a matter of staying with the child, the particular child, to hear her voice, to see his way of approaching and making sense of the world, to look from another angle, to notice, to see the child as she is made visible when engaged in activities of choice in rich, well-provisioned settings, where each one is able to show capacity without preconceived notions of who the child should be or what each one should be able to do at a particular moment in time. It has been a life's work to fully appreciate that observing which enables each child as a person, which enables seeing each child as a person, thinker, learner, is to enact a way of looking free of bias or judgment or predetermined expectation. I'm privileged to be in the classrooms of the Ella Baker School, a public school in New York City, on a regular basis. The children at Ella Baker are visible through their strengths and interests within classrooms rich with materials and the time and space to choose to delve deeply into topics that matter to them. I'm going to share brief vignettes of three Ella Baker children to emphasize my point that you have to get to know each child as a unique individual, each one going about things in a different way, each one presenting a different picture. And I've used pseudonyms here. There are people in the audience who will recognize these children. Sam is a first grader who can be hard to see in school, where so much is based on being verbal, because she doesn't choose to speak much to the adults. She comes to life by talking with her peers, steeped in pretend play and using new vocabulary within a classroom that provides real-life context in which the words come to life. She's becoming a reader by dramatizing the stories books hold and by reading them with her friends or having them read to her. Sam is a dancer who has been able to share her love of dance in school. She is sought out by other children for her expertise in this area. She makes sense of new activities and ideas by modeling what her peers do. She talks most about them. She talks most with them, making evident to those who can hear what she's thinking about and learning in those child-to-child encounters. It's understood by her teachers that pretend play, dance, and socializing provide entry points for this first grader in being a valued member of the classroom community and for the continued learning and for her continued learning and becoming a reader. Another child in the school presents a different sort of picture. Guyana is a kindergartner who knows everything there is to know about the New York City subway system and then some. The stops along each line, the construction of the cars inside and out, what various workers do. He's a strong-minded boy who likes to tell his classmates what to do when they work together in blocks or pretend. He can work for long periods of time on one project, whether a 3D representation of his beloved trains or a drawing of a boat that has special staircases so that old people can get up and down the levels. In his kindergarten classroom over the year, he was supported to pursue his passion for trains, through blocks and wooden train tracks and through junk construction and drawing. He built a child-sized subway car, complete with the required accoutrements inside and out. Guyan spent a great deal of time over the year building and rebuilding an elevated subway line with greater detail and complexity with each new attempt, inspiring his classmates to do the same. His block buildings, drawings of subway cars, and box construction make evident what Guyan knows and cares about. Within the time and space made for this work, he furthered his inquiry, raising new ideas and new questions to pursue. He makes important insights into all aspects of the world through the lens his study of trains provides. And then an older child who already knows he's an artist and supported as one in school. Mike is a third grader who tells everyone he's an artist. He knows that that's what he'll be when he's an adult. His art has been present and made space for since he came to the school as a three-year-old. He works tirelessly, slowly and deliberately on each drawing of superheroes or from life. Each work is testament to Mike's observational skills and to the artistry he has developed through the many hours dedicated to this work in school and at home. The time and space provided within the classroom and school for attention to detail and for the standards he holds for his work enables seeing and understanding how Mike learns best and how to best support his learning in all areas. Why tell about these children? What do we learn from them? I believe we learn many things. We learn about the role of the teacher, which at times is a matter of stepping back for the child who learns best alongside her peers, as Sam does. We learn about the importance of provisioning the classroom for children of all ages with a variety of materials and with the opportunity to choose, as Mike has been able to choose across his early childhood and elementary years. We learn about the need for time to delve deeply into what is important, into big ideas and experiences that matter, the time that enabled Guyan to pursue his amazing inquiry. We learn from the children how the classroom must be provisioned and organized to include the range of interests and approaches to learning of these three and of all the children. I know from experience, as those of you in this auditorium know, that the place to look for precisely what the classroom should be is to the early childhood classroom. We know and appreciate the ways in which a well-thought-out early childhood classroom makes space for every child to participate, to be visible through pursuit of what is of interest, to delve deeply into ideas that engage, ideas cared about in ways that engender rigorous, to use a very popular word these days, rigorous investment of thought, time, energy. This is the nature of early childhood classrooms, such as those in our own ECC and in the kindergarten classroom of my recently retired husband, George, who taught kindergarten for 30 years. This is also the nature of elementary classrooms that bring forward depth of thinking by honoring what the children care about and want to pursue. Classrooms such as those of Ella Baker and in the elementary classrooms of many right here in this auditorium. Now to shift a little bit. At MIT, the renowned Graduate School of Technology in Boston, one of the media labs founded by Mitchell Resnick is entitled Lifelong Kindergarten. The idea embodied by using this name for the Graduate School Media Lab is that in kindergarten there has long been an appreciation for the value of play or loved work, which Resnick is promoting for all ages, all people. In Resnick's words, why kindergarten? As I see it, kindergarten is one of the few parts of our educational system that really works. In kindergarten, kids spend most of their time creating things they care about, building towers out of wooden blocks, making pictures with finger paint, creating castles in the sandbox. As they playfully create and experiment, kids begin to develop new understandings. What makes structures fall down? How do colors mix together? End quote. Creating things they care about to develop new understandings. That is for kindergartners and MIT graduate students, the way to meaning and knowledge. The belief that from a foundation of open-ended, deep, and thoughtful exploration, through active engagement in play and in making things, spring new ideas, new understandings, original works, true invention. This was the heart of what Greenberg teachers valued, what was thought about and planned at the Prospect School, the Workshop Center, in Mamaroneck's classrooms under the leadership of Calvert Schlick, and to this day in early childhood settings and elementary classrooms where teachers hold on to the value of choice, play, open-ended exploration, the value of active making and doing as the center of deep and meaningful learning. This is what is at the heart of all classrooms in which brave teachers find the courage to give children some opportunity to be actively engaged in pursuit of their own ideas and work. In these early childhood and elementary classrooms where teachers try and hold the line on what is appropriate for young and not so young children, threatened now more and more, there's a plethora of stuff and opportunities for making and doing with open-ended arts and construction materials, drama and movement, math and science equipment, books, lots of ways to pursue ideas, to create and express stories. There is the space to choose and the time to go deep into work with these materials. Too many classrooms have become, even in early childhood, word-bound. Without the richness of natural phenomena and arts and construction materials, without access to open-ended science and math inquiry, without time for all types of real-world experiences. Without the rich provisioning of stuff, of time and space to explore and work with what is of interest, children cannot be known in all of their complexity. The five-year-old is now too often relegated to work with paper and pencil for long periods of time, through which most five-year-olds, or even 6 or 7-year-olds, cannot show their best and most capable selves. But bring in the blocks, and the five-year-old's thinking and problem-solving defies that of many adults with an intrinsic approach to figuring out, for example, the physics of a building under construction. By observing the children in well-stocked classrooms where imagination and creativity are valued, following them as they engage in experiences they love, we can truly get to know them. But, as we are well aware, this way of knowing children is not widely recognized for the central role it could play, should play, in teaching each child as a unique individual. What the child can do, the amazing capacity of each one, is too often rendered invisible by expectations and practices that dehumanize, that reduce the children to statistics. What the child cares about, what the child wants for herself, is seldom at the center of education reform. It is rarely understood or valued that by observing what children do when they have choices, when they are pursuing their passions, when they choose what they care about and are good at, we learn how to support them in all aspects of their learning and thereby set them on the path of the transformative education they deserve. A belief in quick fixes, in one right way, in formatted and formulaic methods of instruction and of assessment has almost annihilated, even in once reflective educational communities, trust in the significance of the knowledge made through teacher-driven inquiry into how children think and learn by observing them as they work within richly provisioned classrooms and by looking closely at what they make and do for all that illuminates. How do we hold on to the belief in the capacity of every child to think and learn for herself? How do teachers reclaim trust in the knowledge they hold and make space for the knowledge for that knowledge in their teaching and in their professional growth? Learning with care is the crux of the matter. Teachers must believe and have confidence in the authority that knowing firsthand holds. To see the child as she presents herself to us if we have provisioned spaces for each one to be fully present. To say it again, I believe we have to trust ourselves and the authority of knowledge made each day in classrooms. Classrooms in which teachers trust in the unique capacity of every child to make sense of the world for herself, to be his own best teacher, for children to learn and grow from their relationships with one another, with objects, experiences, actions in their daily lives. It is essential to know Sam, as a first grader, is becoming a reader by being alongside her peers, steeped in pretend play, using new vocabulary within the context that brings the words to life, just as we have to see that while Guyon pursues his amazing passion for trains, he gains insight into all aspects of the world. That Mike's pursuing his passion for art is essential in making school meaningful for him. Tomorrow, those of you in the Institute for the week will have the opportunity to review longitudinal collections of the work of two children. By collecting and looking closely, descriptively at children's work made in classrooms with an abundance of real-world firsthand making and doing, work collected over the child's school life, we have a window to what each particular child cares about, how each goes about making sense, how each one learns. We learn how to teach that particular child, how to provide entry points for all subject matter, for everything we want the child to learn. Looking at the children through the lens of what they do and what they make in this way assists teachers, I believe, to counterbalance the meaningless and reductive data collection now engulfing schools. Documentation of children engaged in meaningful work creates a space for getting to know the particular child in all of her or his complexity and for teaching that child as an individual. The descriptive processes developed at the Prospect School, to which I was introduced all those years ago, are founded on the belief that observing and describing what the child is doing, what the child makes, provides a window to the child as a thinker and learner. What meant so much to me then is all the more valuable now. That by looking closely and by describing children and their work in collaborative circles, what the teacher knows about a particular child is shared and expanded in collaboration with others who know children. To take another angle on this, I was asked recently whether in this dehumanizing educational climate, I have hope. Hope that schools can become more widely places in which the voices of children and the voices of teachers are heard. The question reminded me of something Tony Kushner, the playwright, said recently in a radio interview, and I quote, "We have an ethical obligation to look for hope and find it. It isn't easy, but that doesn't mean it isn't there. In fact, if it were easy, it would be less valuable." He went on to say, "You create its value by the difficulty of the search. We all do it. That's what struggle is. We wouldn't get out of bed otherwise." Hearing those words, I was struck by their relevance in teaching. What is hope? Where do we find it? How do we find the courage to see what is possible? To remain hopeful when we're bombarded by voices that want to drown out, silence, marginalize the voices that really matter, those of the children and of the families and teachers who know and directly care for and about them. How do we together find the hope, the courage to envision possibility and act upon it? How do we make our voices heard once we do? A year ago, for the celebration of the 25th anniversary of the Art of Teaching program here at Sarah Lawrence College, Patricia Carini opened the event with framing remarks entitled, A Tribute to the Art of Teaching. She asked, where then is courage found? Where is courage found to hold firm to the conviction that education and schools can be revolutionized, that teaching can be art, that minds and hearts and heads can be turned around? Where is courage found to stand firm against the degradation of teaching and education? Where is courage found to hold firm to relatedness to children in the knowledge that absent that relatedness, teaching degrades to empty busy work? Where is courage found to accept that forced compromises like mistakes are not the end of the story? That it is possible to continue to stand firm, to remain ever so a seer of children, alert to every opportunity for choice, for play, for storytelling, for pursuit of passions. Within Pat's four questions are multiple calls to action with implied degrees of risk to teachers who take up the call. We have to acknowledge, of course, that the act of finding courage, linked as it is to hopefulness, is especially pertinent and particularly challenging in the current debate regarding teachers and their work. It is so hard to hold firm to one's convictions when administrators, the media, politicians, and even colleagues are putting the weight of child and school performance on the shoulders of teachers who do not have the power to make the changes they believe in. Instead of teachers having the right to develop their own practice, teachers are subjected to the aforementioned formulaic, scripted, so-called teacher-proof programs and curriculum. But Pat Carini reminds us that though teachers are forced, now and always, to make compromises, we can, must, continue to find opportunities for what we hold dear, find hope or that even in the current climate in education, this is not the end of the story. The belief and hope that what the children do and say matters, what teachers do and say matters. We can't all be rabble-rousers, though surely we need some, and we can't all afford to put ourselves out there and risk position or status. But all teachers can take a stand by joining with others, keeping vigilant to the opportunities that do exist. Do what has been done over generations. Come together, as teachers in Greenberg did, in solidarity on behalf of children and what is in their best interest, captured in an image Pat Carini shared in a 2009 talk at the Prospect Center. Quote, hands clasping across the years, those of teachers and administrators and activists who preceded us in the struggle for better, more open, more humane schools, reaching out to grip the hands of teachers and administrators and activists who continue that struggle now. Merely by sharing with others what you're doing, or even what you wished you could do, you hold a place for new possibility and acknowledge that it could be otherwise. It is when oppressed individuals or groups are kept apart so that each one feels alone and without power that little change can happen. In not so subtle ways, administrators can divide and conquer when they keep teachers from having any real conversations, and when they maintain control over all aspects of professional work without valuing what teachers know. The act of resistance, of courage, of hopefulness requires, I believe, thoughtful and constant reflection on what we value for children and teaching, never arrived at, always worked toward. Having trust in children and trust in ourselves and in the authority of the knowledge made about teaching and learning by observing and documenting children in their work and through teacher collaboration. Advocating for meaningfulness, for what is truly authentic and important in educating. And looking for the cracks, for the places to subvert what is not in the children's best interest. In her powerful commencement remarks a few weeks ago, our own Sarah Lawrence College president, Karen Lawrence, spoke of teaching as artisanal when its heart and soul is the relationship between student and teacher. Quote, handmade and crafted by teacher and student together in a non-assembly line approach to teaching and learning. She underscored the value of an education whose premise is that, quote, people learn in different ways and at different tempos, and that there is no one path to becoming an educated person. President Lawrence acknowledged that this understanding translates into an extraordinary commitment of time and care with the aim of having a transformative effect on the person, the learner. A very tall order, but one dedicated teachers take up each day. And so artists, teachers as artists, must struggle, grapple with the complexity of humanness that comes together within each classroom every school. When teaching is art, there are no easy answers, no quick fixes, no one right way. We have to accept that it doesn't become self-evident, even after years of teaching. Accept that teaching is about looking for deep meaning through ongoing, thoughtful, noticing, describing, documenting. Teaching is an inquiry with no final resting place, an art needing constant review, rigorous reflection, and well-considered rethinking and remaking. Teachers must know every child as an individual, know what each one cares about and how each one thinks and learns. There's no getting away from it. Teachers have to struggle to make the space they can within the classroom, space in which every child can know what she is capable of, deepen what he is interested in. All curriculum, including and perhaps especially what is mandated, has to have multiple entry points so that each child can relate, connect, make sense of. Just as Sam could bring her dancing, Mike his art, and Guyon his knowledge of trains to bear. And we have to strive to make what children do in school be about big ideas that matter to them and that matter in the world. From a very early age, school can and should be about knowing how to find out, having habits of mind that enable current and future thinking and learning, and the capacity and confidence to think about what we, the adults, haven't yet begun to consider. I believe this is what Mitchell Resnick meant, creating things they care about to develop new understandings. And so, reclaim teaching as art, crafting our work with children, keeping alive the possibility, ready for a new day by finding the courage to look for every chance, no matter how small, to create space for the child and the children's voices. I want to add now a few more brief examples from classrooms to illuminate how this can occur, is occurring. Just a few more examples of making space for the voices of children. I call attention to the courage of the second grade teacher who provisions the classroom with a well-stocked block area and pushing the envelope very far for what is acceptable in her school for children beyond kindergarten. The courage of the beginning teacher who provides work time for children in her second grade classroom, provisioning arts and other hands-on materials and the space to make and do, while making every effort to articulate to administrators and fellow teachers the value of the work done when children have choices. And there's the teacher who became excited about a new math concept, which many would think is beyond the capacity of first and second graders, but who found entry points to bring it to life for these young children, connecting it to the world they know, opening up new ways of thinking about math and its place in the world. And even older children, for even older children, the teacher who found canvases and paint, connects, and other arts and construction materials, and who provided the time to pursue these loved materials within the very full curriculum teachers of upper grade children are responsible for. And then, the kindergarten teacher who kept at it, working hard to pull forward the strengths of a child who was too readily seen as merely disruptive. Over the kindergarten year, he was supported to work alongside others, learning how to share his point of view and how to negotiate differences, which of course required a great deal of patience from his teacher. He was given, as were all the children in this classroom, the freedom of choice of materials and activities, and he became adept, not only in his making and doing, but in sharing his work in the circle. His teacher had confidence in him, trust that he could work alongside others, given the time and opportunity to work things out for himself under her caring eye. His ideas were valued by his teacher, and so by the other children. He was from the start a participating and contributing member of the classroom community. The positive outlook taken enabled this child to see new possibilities in and for himself, and for the other children to see him in a new light within the classroom. It is so important to look for and share these teaching stories with one another, to see the ways in which teachers are making a difference, even within the restrictive climate that seeks to silence both teachers and children. With the examples I just shared in mind, I invite you all to consider the ways in which you and teachers you know are finding the courage, making space, bringing each child's voice to bear, to support each one to be an active learner in pursuit of interests and open to new ideas in the world, to become contributing members of the community of the classroom and of the world. What I believe is central in finding hope in education today is holding on to a vision of childhood as possibility. to believe in and trust children, to understand that children and childhood cannot be normative nor standardized, not conforming nor compliant, allowing each child to be who she or he is of his or her generation, recognizing the importance of variety within our humanness and the value of what each of us, teacher and child, contribute to the world. Without hope and trust in children, we risk losing the freshness, the restorative energy that children bring to the world. Without valuing the possibility of childhood, there is no reason to hope. In teaching, too, there can be no reason to keep at it, to rethink, rework, remake, if we don't believe we can affect change, believe that schools can be places of possibility for every child. I believe we have to hold a vision that takes us beyond schools as places that merely prepare children for the next grade, the next level of schooling, for the workplace, which of course is Mr. Obama's mantra. In school, children come together in their own generation to make sense together, to see who each one is and wants to be, to find what each can and will contribute to the world, make it a better place in their own way. Schools can be places where thoughtful, intellectual, caring teachers come together to offer children the chance to be who they are and want to be, through education that is, as Karen Lawrence believes it should be, transformative. I couldn't be doing the work I'm doing in teacher education if I didn't have hope. What has given me hope now over the 26 years in the art of teaching is in passing the baton onto thoughtful, caring new teachers who every year brave the obstacles, surmount the many hurdles, fight the good fight on behalf of children. These are teachers who understand they were not promised a rose garden. They know, as Tony Kushner knows, that if it were easy, it would be less valuable. These amazing, energetic teachers have held the space, the place, for their own voices and for those of their children, entering schools to work alongside other dedicated teachers to take up the charge and find the courage in the belief that it can be otherwise. Each year at Sarah Lawrence College, a group of teachers comes together for a few Saturdays to participate in our Art of Teaching Saturday seminars. The group is made up of Art of Teaching alumni, their colleagues, wonderful mentor teachers who host our student teachers, and other friends of our program. Our purpose is to try and find some of what Prospect and the Workshop Center offered in that earlier time, a space to reflect on and share the knowledge we make firsthand by being with children, to try and reclaim the space for teacher voices, to hold on to what is authentic, to trust in the authority of knowledge made by actual children and actual teachers. If teachers reclaim their voices alongside other thoughtful teachers in intellectual circles, such as our Saturday seminars, if the classroom is reclaimed as a place for children to make sense of the world and themselves by pursuing big ideas and interests through making and doing, if observation and documentation of what children make and do is reclaimed for what is learned about teaching each child as an individual, then there is hope. There is hope that the classroom can belong to the children and to their teachers, reclaimed as spaces for joyful, engaging, deeply meaningful thinking and learning. Thank you. Conversation, discussion.
I couldn't agree with you in terms of your reflection and your vision, having that I think I probably am the same vintage. My question to you, though, is a component that I felt was missing, is the family, the parent. How do you link that in today's educating them and participation in?
I think it's the biggest piece of work we have to do. Did everybody hear the question? I think it's a huge piece of work, and I think that educators are largely responsible for the confusion out there among parents and among families. When Pat Carini and I worked in the Mamaroneck School, we were able to bring a group of parents together on a regular basis to to look at the work of Children Together, which is what we'll be doing in the Institute tomorrow, to say what is learned through real work. What is it that stands apart from, you know, the sort of that ditto sheet that's stuck on the refrigerator? Why do we value that? What's that about? Let's look at what the alternatives are. Let's talk with parents about what it really means to think and learn. That conversation, I believe, can only happen between the teachers and parents. I don't think it should be top down. I think it has to be bottom up. And I think the collaboration I was talking about as a teacher collaboration can certainly be parent and teacher collaboration. I also think we have to invite parents into the classroom. There's sort of this like invisible barrier that stands there, and parents are not welcome to really to come in and to really see the work that their children are doing. It's not enough to have a conference a year, a couple of conferences a year. Right. I also think that we have to invite parents in to tell us about the children outside of school. The picture is very incomplete if it's only a school picture. And so how do we invite their knowledge in? How do we share back and forth who the child is that we're each seeing? And so I should say to you that those collections that we're going to be looking at tomorrow are collections from Ella Baker, where collections of children's work, it's also at the Central Park East One School, other schools in the New York metro area, where work is collected over the child's school life. And when the parent comes in for their parent conference, the child presents their work to the parent. And the conversation is around that work. So that's a very important way of bringing the parent in, I think. Jen?
Just to speak to that, something that happened to me this year, I had a little girl in my class who was very much like the little girl you described, being very quiet. And I had popsicle sticks in my classroom in the art area. So during activity time, she would use the popsicle sticks. And through her use of the popsicle sticks, I was really able to see what kind of thinking she did in terms of engineering and problem solving. And she constructed like this house with the popsicle sticks standing up on their ends, rather than laying them out flat and building like that little square thing that goes up and up and up. She stood them on their ends and was able to connect them to make this structure that really stood up. And this is first grade. If I didn't have that material there, I would never be able to see that she had that kind of intellectual capacity. So at the end of the day, it went out with her to, when she was going home. And I was able to talk to her mom about it and what I saw in that work and what that helped me to understand about this little girl. And the mom turns to me and she says, "Are you the only classroom that has popsicle sticks?" But that was huge.
Yeah.
That was huge. Just the fact that she understood the importance of those popsicle sticks and what that can do for her daughter or, for any child. But, it also has to do with helping parents understand mm-hmm. what you're doing in the classroom and how that brings forward a child's knowledge of the world and making meaning.
I love what you said toward the end. I didn't catch the phrase. It had to do something about the energy of mm-hmm. childhood in terms of hope, and it made me think of why I like to see puppies so much. Walk down the street. The puppies bring all this enthusiasm and the excitement of life. The field drives them and I think it's that energy of getting in the kindergarten, the kids are bringing it, and it gives us the hope. It gives us, re-energizes us, and gives us this hope that we often get dead in this. As you say, if we're shredding this to pieces through the standardization, then what this means for generations, society,
dire. And it isn't only the adults that have lost that puppy-like quality, but when you get to third grade, fourth grade, and you begin to see in certain schools the heaviness of kids going into the classroom. is like those older dogs. Oh, yeah, hi.
Hi. I want to sort of speak for the parents, although maybe not all of them, but as someone who also was Bank Street trained many years ago, I have a great deal of concern about the way school is done now, especially having two children in elementary school and middle school. And I wonder, you know, I guess there's a couple things. One is that this kind of progressive education has actually been around a long time. I mean, Bank Street is all about observation, child-centered education. And I feel, as a parent struggling with this in 2011, I hate to say it, but kind of hopeless. Like, this, there's such a huge tidal wave of sort of fact-based, you know, anti-imaginative kind of teaching. And I'm not even convinced, at least in the small, somewhat conservative town where I live, that the parents or even many of the teachers really share my values of wanting the same thing you want, which, you know, which I agree everything you said. So I'm not sure what the question is in there exactly, but just I wonder if there needs to be some maybe larger paradigm shift somehow in our society or something to really affect the change.
Yeah, well, I think one thing is to be careful of the word progressive. You know, and because I think the umbrella is much bigger, and I really think that this is about, first of all, about a more humane, more humanistic way of thinking about people. But I would take it from the angle of science, for example. I think we're in very big trouble right now in our schools, that so little is happening with that has anything to do with thinking in a scientific way, which I think requires imagination and creativity. I think we have to sort of grab hold of those people who might not consider anything progressive for their children to think of how are schools becoming more and more narrowly focused on the word, to be word bound, and also even that in a very unimaginative, uncreative way. And so that if in fact we're looking at sending people out into the world who are thinkers, who can invent, who can create new things, have ideas of their own, which I assume not too many parents would disagree they want for their children, that we have to take it from that angle. This is not, you know, I think the word play has always held an unfortunate place, but that's why I used Mitchell Resnick at MIT as an example, because I think what he says is profound, that this is about graduate students as well, and that the way to really be able to think outside the box, so to speak, is to play with ideas, to play with stuff, to think alongside of other people who are doing the same thing. So I think it's all about how we shape it, how to make that paradigm shift.
Well, just a quick postscript. There was 1 week my daughter was learning about the eye in fifth grade, and it was a week of label the parts of the eye. That was the entire concept.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
What you're saying.
Yeah.
The other thing is I'm sort of part of the, I don't want to say anti-homework movement, but I focused a lot of my energy, and I hope other people will consider as well, on at least reducing homework and making
here.
It more creative and thoughtful.
Absolutely.
Instead of just worksheets.
Absolutely.
And we're very lucky to have this person helping us get grants and work with grants and foundations at Sarah Lawrence.
I haven't been here in a very long time, and I don't know if you realize that this is a source of your life here. And I don't say that lightly. And sad what's going on in the schools.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I can say it. But anyway, the first time I realized it was serious was when I was told that the journal Latin
Well, but we've had, the pendulum has swung back and forth many times. And I believe what Pat Carini said, this is not the end of the story. It can't be the end of the story, as I said. This can't be the end of the story. I have to have hope. I have to have hope because I have these wonderful students and former students who are out there fighting the good fight in schools. I think there are schools that are very, very hard to turn around, and that is unfortunate because they're the schools that need it the most. But I really believe that you can just talk to kids in a different tone, and that makes a difference within the setting of your classroom.
Oh, and they are willing.
Yeah.
You know, what I'm saying is the children are willing. What you're saying is, but wow, you're really tired by the time, you know, you've gone through to the children. It's already almost June.
Yeah.
So then the children leave, and you go, okay, what, you know, remnants of what I brought forth that was in any way creative, who will they retain? Mm-hmm. You know, what remnants of what I gave them and said, you know, hey, you know, this is good. You can read a book and enjoy it. I mean, I had kids reading a book for the first time. Kids who didn't have a library card, and I said, ouch, you know. So, again, thank you, because every time I come here, I get refreshed, and I go, okay, yeah, there are people who are really teaching.
Can someone come from a high school perspective?
I think the problem becomes, you know, all your stories, most of your stories, were kindergarten, first, second, third grade, and MIT. Something happens between those years. And what happens is, I would venture to guess that very few of the students in the art teaching program go into high school teaching.
Well, they're not certified for high school.
Well, and there are no programs for that.
Yeah.
There's no programs for the art and teaching,
yeah,
for the high school teacher. There are no programs. Mm-hmm. And there are no programs for the art of administrating for administrators.
Yeah.
So you have music teachers that got certificate, and now they're an administrator. Soon they're superintendent of schools, and on and on and on. I've been coming here for 30 years now. And the same thing, you know, you have all these terrific first, second, and third grade teachers.
And fifth and sixth.
And fifth and sixth.
Yeah, but that's rare. That's very rare.
And middle school.
Very rare.
Middle school.
Yeah.
But we have a teacher that taught kindergarten for 18 years, and then she's put into the sixth grade.
Yeah.
And that made that sixth grade great on that.
Yeah. It's what Deborah Meyer said a long time ago, that everybody should start out as a teacher of kindergartners. Yeah, before they go any place else.
Mary, it's always so such a pleasure, but so deep and moving to hear you speak. And I am now an administrator in high school. And challenged, because the students who are in my high school are everything that you describe in your scenarios of those three children. And I think what happens
And your YouTube thing makes me also think about, and in response to what Ed is bringing up, one of the things that I learned that was so valuable at Prospect School too is to share recollections of our own childhood, to remember what it means to be 14. To remember what it means to be 5, but to remember what it means to be 14 really gets you back in touch with who those children are, who those people are. What does that music mean to them? What does cutting up the shirts mean to them? We have to reconnect. We can never lose sight of what it means to be a child, to be an adolescent. Telling those stories, which people who have been in my classes know, are the centerpiece to get you back to reconnect to your own stories in childhood, in adolescence, is critical importance, I think. Sheila?
That reminds me of a young teacher who was left the lower grades and put into the sixth grade and went back to her own sixth grade diary to understand what it meant to be that age. Which
yeah.
I think is very moving.
Yeah. Amy?
I just remember talking this past year several times about putting a call out to administrators and also parents to recollect on their own childhoods and, you know, to have the parent who's pushing their kid to do better in math remember their own struggles
absolutely.
And how they got to be where they are. And to have administrators take the standardized tests that they're giving to their kids and see how ridiculous they are in so many ways before they
a great way to reach out to parents. Yeah.
Just in regard to the pendulum swinging back, I don't know what this is going to do, if anything, but July 30th is going to be a huge march, hopefully huge, on Washington, with an organization called Saving Our Schools. And I don't know if Sarah Lawrence has endorsed that. Or not.
Well, we've emailed everybody in the world. We have some people, I'm sure, putting buses together and whatever. Yeah.
So everybody here.
Very important. Stand up, Jen, so they can.
July 30th.
Stand up.
Save our schools.
On July 30th, there's going to be a march in Washington. It will be, I think it begins July 28th and it runs through the 30th. So there are seminars and conferences. And Diane Ravitch is going to be there. And Richard Dreyfuss will be there as well. That's how we got to know. It's Save Our Schools, and it's to get rid of
Arnie Duncan. And we have to find points of connection because, I'm sure that people going will make strange bedfellows, but we have to sort of find our points of connection, so that's why I say we avoid the word progressive because we have to sort of put out a bigger net, whatever that expression is, or have a bigger umbrella that is really about the children and what's in their best interest. And I think I think that is a good sign. I think that's a good sign. George?
Further their talents along. And
at the risk of embarrassing Dr. Schlick, the kinds of... The kinds of interviews that he conducted in Mamaroneck were very unique because the teachers were asked what they were interested in. What do you do in your life that you can bring into your classroom? That's not the tact now. The tact now is, do you know Words Their Way? Do you know Turk? Do you know this particular program, which next week will be out of fashion, will be obsolete. But what Dr. Schlick was asking is, who are you as a person interested in the world, and how will you bring that interest to your work in the classroom with children? That's what we need to return to. That's what's not there in so many places now. And that's a big problem. Robert. Say a little louder.
A dialogue between the lower school teachers, the high school teachers, and undergraduate college, and human resource gatekeepers of job. It seems that there might be more power within the educational system than the undergraduate colleges. If they had more of a voice about not depending on SATs and wanting to expand modeling, and this is
I don't know how unusual Karen Lawrence is in what she, in her perspective that I shared, our president here of the undergraduate college and the graduate college, whether in fact other school, undergraduate schools are looking for students that come up with the ability to make ideas, to have those habits of mind, to be respectful of the individual's perspective. I would hope there's more than just the one, but I think that's a really important thought, is what are we as a society looking for? Not only higher education, but what are we as a society looking for? What do we want children to be able to have for themselves in their lives? I think that's a really important.
And specifically, if the undergraduate colleges came out with a statement and said, we're not looking for good test takers, well then the whole testing institution would dissolve.
Yeah.
Because that wouldn't be the market anymore. The market would be bankers, people who are inspired. So there may be a little more of a conversation between educational institutions as well as the other dynamics in the marketplace. Because also when they graduate from undergrad and grad school and you go for your job, the way that they're continually asking you to differentiate is the person who arrives who does more than the software program, who has the original idea. So there seem to be a couple parties in the conversation.
I also invite you to, I suggest that you go to the internet to look up Mitchell Resnick, because he's actually doing a lot of work on behalf of children, and his thoughts about, you know, what does it mean to be at MIT as one institution of higher education, I think speaks to that really well.
Read this chapter and I will give you a clue.
today.
Today. You should all look at that. It's bad. They're having serial intense encounters in which you have to discuss some ethical issue with a series of people. But the idea is they want people who can think, who can relate, who can have a conversation, who can be part of a team. So it's not, I mean, on one level, those things are well understood by the people who are out there. And but I think that the system is so entrenched that it doesn't, those ideas don't touch.
And the standardized testing affects a lot of that. And so it's one of the places we really have to press hard on to undermine standardized testing, and the high stakes aspect of those tests is just really gotten way out of control. Yeah.
I just wanted to say one thing. I was fortunate enough to go to graduate school here in the child development program, and I find one of the biggest challenges is sort of bridging the conversation with people who are interested in child development or in the art of teaching. And I wish I could remember exactly where the article was, but one of the most effective tools for me has been an article about teaching our children to function only within these limits and these very structured, not giving them the opportunity to think outside of the box is really a threat to democracy, to our country as a whole. And I think that, you know, to have a language to bridge what we believe about early education with how it affects our entire country has been really effective for me. And so I think one of our jobs is to find those languages and ways to have the conversation outside.
Yeah, I think rereading Dewey, reading Paulo Freire can't ever help, can never be a bad thing. Tricia?
I was going to say, when I heard you speak, I thought of my cousin who, he goes to MIT, and he actually works in like some super smart whatever lab. He created something out of like 90 things from around the house, and it's apparently like this next big thing that's like mind-blowing. And so when I read it, I was like, oh my God, you did junk instruction.
Smart answer.